Welcome back, folks. Dow right now up 70. NASDAQ is down 63. S&Ps are up 3.5. Let's go over to our man, Mr. Jason Path, as we do every Tuesday and Thursday at 9:15. Jason, what's going on, brother?
Tom, getting ready for tonight, man. I mean, you said it well. You know, we have a couple of times a year where maybe the evening and the nighttime after hours market's more exciting than the day, and I think we definitely have that teed up this week, or at least today.
Oh, there's no doubt, man. And you know, what happens here, folks, is that the last couple of weeks of the last quarter, of course, that's when this thing hit. The real question is going to be inside Google, is that what are they going to say going forward? So it's a big number. And, you know, Facebook is tomorrow. So wherever Google goes, I think advertising wise, it's going to, you know, affect the Facebook stock after hours today.
Yeah, absolutely. You certainly expect expectations. What would be really interesting is if they diverged. Clearly, you know, no one really knows, but it's going to be fascinating. You know,
yes.
Obviously, Google's a proxy for, you know, other businesses given their dependence on advertising spend. Best as I can tell, you know, spends off 20-25%. That's a conservative, you know, forecast. But again, to your point, it's that subjective go forward forecast. What do they expect to see ahead of them? And that's, I think it's so hard as a trader right now, because you really, you know, what does executives say on those calls is everything right now.
It is.
It's the hardest thing to know, right?
It is. Hey, so we got the Fed, you got the ECB. Let's talk about central banks.
Yeah, wild week, right? And you had Bank of Japan earlier in the week stating they're going to do whatever it took, unlimited purchases in the bond buying program. They're already buying ETFs. You got the ECB Thursday. And I continue to say, and we talked about this last week, Europe's in just such a tough spot. They really have not recovered from the Great Recession or the debt crisis. They're certainly not doing much here, and their economies have been stagnating. I don't think the ECB does much this week either. I think that's very bearish for the euro. I think it's a political problem that's manifesting itself with economic consequences. There's not much the ECB can do to resolve that. I think long-term, short-term, medium-term, it's going to be really challenging for the euro.
Yeah.
My longer term euro forecast to some might be shocking, but, you know, I think we've got a 20-30% move over an extended period of time. But as the rest of the world pulls out of this, there's no question in my mind that they're going to be the laggard. They're going to be susceptible to a second wave. They have not gotten the debt problems, the political problems, anything else out of their system yet. And now they're just compounding it.
So
go ahead.
No, it's pretty cool here, man. I remember. So this is, well, I don't remember this, okay? But yeah, 20%, that's the last time the euro traded like that at 80 cents was in 2000, man.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. And when you look at the dollar, and clearly, you know, the dollar will, you know, it could be coming off its highs right now, but will continue to strengthen, you know,
yeah,
world reserve currency as the euro is weak. And I think the euro is disproportionately weak against the yen. And again, it's a tale of two central banks. You have the BOJ literally saying we'll do whatever it takes earlier this week. Again, you got geopolitical threats on the horizon, which will benefit the yen, like North Korea. No one really knows what's happening with them, but that's not going to be a good story, right? That'll strengthen the yen.
Yeah. You know what's amazing?
The euro just continues to slip.
Jason, what's amazing, and I think, folks, that you can really see how strong the United States is. And you also can see, you know, for the mantra that, you know, government's too big, I want smaller government, I want all that. I guarantee you, folks, after this is over, if you haven't seen what the government has done, and you know, they've kept us alive. So there's going to be a whole different dynamic here about, you know, throwing eggs at the government on a continual basis, because you can see the differential, kind of what you're talking about, why Europe is basically history, because they're not powerful enough to do it, number one, and they're too, you know, so many countries, they're just too separate, it seems it. Do you know what
yeah,
I'm saying?
It's too fragmented.
And yeah.
You've got...
Thank you. Yeah.
You've got Norway with, you know, a pretty sound economic picture, but they're dealing with the oil crisis. You've got Italy and Spain in the south with the debt. Germany trying to thread the needle. You know, Merkel has said she's going to be out of office in 12 to 18 months. She's going to retire. Who knows what happens there? This thing is going to continue to fragment and splinter, and the EU
is in
trouble.
Oil. Let's talk oil, man.
I mean,
it's $12.69, man.
What's so funny is never before in my life have I had to check the percentages. Normally, right, we look at these numbers so often. I know it was 12.70. Like, I forget, like, I hear 13 and I need the context of the percentage because it's all still so foreign and it's moving so much.
Right.
You, from session to session, hour to hour, I need to reset on the percentages of where we've been. You know, again, I mean, just oil is, I know we're changing topics, but similar story. I mean, it's just under extreme pressure and going to continue to be very bearish. You know, the ETFs and the commodity indexes are already rolling to June to try and take some pressure off a month, but. You know, we're going to be full on storage by mid-May.
Now, hey, do you still live in Oklahoma?
No, I'm from Oklahoma.
Yeah,
but
you're from Oklahoma.
I live in the D.C. area now.
Okay,
yeah.
I got it. No, because I know Oklahoma is a monster oil state, right?
Oh, yeah, oil and gas, yeah.
Right, okay.
The horizontal wells are all over the place, absolutely. Okay. And, you know, it's interesting you bring up Oklahoma because this week, and this is a little bit of a nuanced oil and gas story, but they've told producers that they can shut in their wells and not break the lease. Typically, if you shut in your well, you break your lease because you're paying, you know, royalties to the landholder.
Okay.
But that should help us shut in production. I think that's a bullish, positive gas story because producers will be more likely to shut in production. But oil's got the time for oil to get healthy, for this market to get healthy, is going to be better measured in certainly months, if not years at this point.
Yeah.
It's just going to be a long time.
And so now let's flip that and go into the gas market, because what does happen, of course, is that the gas is almost, is it a byproduct of oil? I mean, it almost seems it, right?
Yeah. I mean, especially in the horizontal wells, you get what's called associated gas. 10 to 12% of the natural gas produced in this country is while drilling for oil,
which is
a significant number. And you know, the oil is typically, you know, led for many companies, you know, the capitalization and the profits and the cash flow from oil have fed some gas production. Gas production has ramped up. You've got LNG and some other places. You know, folks like Chevron have tried to monetize gas, but they've really used the oil profits to lead that. But as those wells get shut in, and we're seeing a record rate of rigs come off the field. Again, I really think that's net bullish for gas. I think we could be looking at $2.50, $3 gas potentially by early to midsummer if the weather gets constructive as well. Because as you know, gas produces electricity
sure.
for much of the country. But as the country opens back up, it's been very cool in some places. Weather's been a barbell. We've had it cool up north and they're burning heat. Very hot down in Florida and in Texas, and folks have got the AC on. And folks have switched with the lower gas prices from coal to gas. You know, I've been buying futures in, you know, 150 to 160 range, you know, multi-year lows, and I think we could be up by $2.50, $3 by midsummer. Very constructive.
On the gas, yeah.
No. On the gas is developing.
You know, and gas has been going down for so long. I mean, I know we can get to zero. We know we can go negative now, but the reality is that with all those oil wells shut down, it's going to make a big difference, man, no doubt.
Absolutely. And gas is much less sensitive to the demand problems that we've had because, again, we're still in our homes. We're still heating and cooling. We're still using electricity.
No doubt.
Not the demand destruction we've seen in oil.
Well, listen, man, we appreciate the update, and I look forward to speaking to you Thursday.
All right, man. We'll talk Elon Musk and his pay package with Tesla.
Yeah. Oh, good.
Can't wait.
Oh, my God. It's coming up. Stay right there, folks. Coming right back. Dow's up 84. NASDAQ's down 64. S&P's are up 4. We're coming right back.